She had broken up with her boyfriend, and so she was miserable, which I was thinking, cha-ching. I'm gonna get some good songs out of this.
Hey, I'm Josh Fountain, and we're here at Roundhead Studios. I am about to break down some sessions and spill all my knowledge. The first session we're gonna look at today is a song called Supalonely by Benee.
Stella and I did a writing trip over to the States last year, and the idea was to sort of get her a little bit more used to working with other producers, and we thought we'd start the week off with a session with this girl, Jenna Andrews, who we met through Songhubs,
yeah.
And she was real cool.
She's a force of nature, isn't she?
That's one way to describe her. She's got an energy, which is really good, because I'm kind of like this. I'm like, cool, man. Like, the difference between me like liking something and not liking something is not, I'm not super dynamic. I'm not going to be jumping up around the room going, woohoo, we got one. So it's great to sort of work with someone who can bring that energy, who's like super excited, that real kind of chaotic US energy.
Yeah.
I got in on the Friday, and then on the Saturday, we did our first session and we wrote Supalonely. But yeah, the session started off with Stella. You know, she's broken up with her boyfriend and she's feeling down, but she wants to write she doesn't want to write a sad song about it. She wants to kind of write a happy song, or disguise it as a happy song. She's like, I want it to have guitars in it, which always sends me into a panic because I don't really play guitar. So I'm kind of scrambling in my head thinking like, what am I going to do? And I've had this one, I think it was like the time I was like real into splice. You can see there's like a couple of splices. There's an Oliver hi-hat loop in there. But I had these like one-shot guitar chords that I quickly just like chucked into the session. Just strums. And I just had that, and she's like, oh, I like that. So I found another one, and then these ended up being the two chords that we based the whole song on. And because it was, I was in such a rush, I didn't have anything prepared, so I was just trying to like work real quick. And I don't usually do like two chord songs. I like to kind of make it a little bit more jazzy. But we had the two chords, and I chucked them through. Again, at the time, RC20 was real popular. You guys know RC20? It's like kind of the instant vibe machine. For those of you who don't know, you probably all know it already, but it's you can just chuck it on anything and it's going to sound good. So you can, you know, you can add like vinyl noise. I don't know if that's coming through. Hey, oh, there it is. You can't beat that analog sound, man, that classic analog sound. A bit of like vinyl, a bit of wobble and distortion, and I've filtered it out quite a lot just to give it a bit more vibe. You can hear it without it. And then with it, just kind of making it a little bit wobbly and interesting. You can see as well, a little bit further down the line, I've sidechained it to the kick drum. Just to give it a bit more, movement and a bit more groove in the beat. So with the kick in there. Just kind of helps it move a little bit more and makes it feel a little bit more natural. So I started putting in the drums, like super basic drums. I think there's something that I really like doing with my drums is just keeping them super sparse. Kicks and snare on the 1 and 3 and 2 and 4, like I like to do sort of more funky, I hate that word, but funky bass lines, I guess. So like heaps of space in between the drums like lets me get away with some slightly more funky licks on the bass. Maybe I might go through drum layering in a little bit, But I think that the next part that I added was the keys, which are these guys. Which, there's a couple of things that happened in this session which were just like nice, happy accidents. And this keys patch just happened to be the very first patch that I pulled up, just randomly. I remember I was using Analog Lab. And I think I just went to synths, keys, and I saw Soda Beach. And I thought, oh, that sounds interesting. And I think I just like played it in on my like QWERTY keyboard in here and then reprogrammed it. And it was like, oh yeah, cool, okay, that works. Like, let's keep going. What else can we add? So it all came together super fast. And then I put the bass in. So the bass, you might see it, you'll see it in a few of my sessions, but I don't really play bass, but I'm good at programming in bass. So I, you know, I can play it on keyboards and like hammer it in like two finger styles. So I program a lot of my bass in MIDI, which makes it a bit tough for when people come to play it live, because they're trying to play a bass line that was written on a keyboard but on a guitar. So it can make it a bit funny for the poor old bassist. But this is the bass that I used for Supalonely, and the bass that I use on quite a lot of Benee stuff actually. And it's just the Rick and Backer bass in Contact. So you might have seen it before, but it's a great, great sounding, kind of natural picked bass. And you can see, I mean, I'm sure Spike probably did some stuff on it, but I didn't have it running through anything. I didn't use anything on it. It was just completely raw. I think that's probably just it sounded pretty good in the writing session, so I didn't want to mess with it too much. I didn't want to, you know, you don't want to spend half an hour trying to dial in a bass sound. I programmed. I remember playing that bass in. I bought a little Akai mini keyboard off Amazon Prime, I think, just before I left New Zealand, and it arrived at the accommodation like just as I got there. So I was like, I had this tiny little keyboard that I was like trying to program in this bass line. Sounds horrible like this. often these things sound horrible on their own. Oh, and there's a bass slide sample. So I've just tuned those. I've tuned those bass slaps with Old Mate Sound Shifter to make sure they're in tune. But it's one of those things where if you're worrying too much about how things sound in solo, well, often things can sound great on their own, but they're not so great in the mix. So I know with the slaps, I needed something that was going to like cut through the mix and add that percussiveness, which these guys do really well. Another thing I like to do, like if I don't have access to a great guitar player, or you know, if I don't have a guitar or something, I can't like fumble it out myself. I'll play something on that same Rickenbacker bass, and then just like pitch it up and distort it. So that's what I've done in the post chorus, just to add a bit more excitement. And it lends so much kind of energy and emphasis on that part, because the bass line in itself is kind of hooky, you know, super catchy. So It's just kind of underlining that and making that part more of a moment. I try not to layer up too many drums, and I like to program my drums on the grid, which I don't know why, I just always have done it that way. It's just the way that I'm used to. I've got my main kick here, nice and weighty. It sounds great on its own, but once it's in the mix with everything, it doesn't have the definition that I would like. So I did layer something on top of it, a kick top, which is just a sample that I liked the front end of. So without the EQ. That's without the EQ, and all I've done is roll off all the low end of that. I just want that click so that together makes one super tight sound. And I like things pretty tight and snappy as opposed to woofy. Usually I would probably like fade some of that off, but in the moment it sounded good. And we've got the snare here. Very straight, just the way I like it. Got a clap on top of that. Often with my claps, I'll go in and just nudge them off grid a little bit. Just so it sounds a bit more natural and not so on the beat. You could, if you have it on the beat, like so, it will sound fine. But off the beat, it sounds a bit more natural, and it also means like the transients of each sample aren't like overlapping and causing a big spike as well, which can be a nuisance. The thing that I don't do very well in my sessions, especially during writing sessions, is get my gain staging right, which is should be the number one rule. That it's like the first thing you learn when I was at mains and stuff about, you know, not going in too hot. But it's hard when, like, if I'm getting a sample off Splice or something and I drag it in and the sample's all like smashed and super loud, it sounds great. And I just start working away, and then before I know it, everything's like at zero and like peaking, and I'm trying to pull it all down. It sounds like a mess, but I'm too far gone by that stage. So I'm trying to keep my gain staging in check when I can remember, and like turn everything down like, you know, 15 dB or something, so I've got heaps of headroom to play with. But you'll notice in these sessions that I will be clipping the buses, and I will be going to the red, but that's all, you know, at the end of the day, as long as it kind of sounds okay, I think that's all right. The other thing I like to do in like my drum loops is sort of put some kind of weird percussion-y thing in there. So in this case, it's this kind of like a tom hit. Again, some sort of one shot, which you'd never really notice in the song, but you just feel it. I've used a hi-hat loop here, which I've stretched and chopped up to fit the groove. And if you guys do have Splice, you need to download all the Oliver drum sounds, because they're just the best pop drum sounds you can get, I reckon, at the moment. Just like real nice kicks and snares and claps and kind of a bit of an 80s vibe, but in a way that still feels modern. But it was interesting going through the session, because this hi-hat was originally at 80 BPM. And we're at 30, so I really stretched it. This was the original hat. Like double time kind of hat. And I've just kind of stretched it to fit this. And kind of like just put that open hi-hat in a slightly different position. The other thing is the fill. This is like probably my favorite fill. Kakakong. You'll hear that all the time in songs that I make. I love it. And I was wondering about that tom. So I've chopped this tom from like another drum fill. So I just like the tom sound of that. I love like a good dry tom. So I've obviously just chopped that and used that as my tom sound. So yeah, the drums in this song are just super, super simple, super straightforward with heaps of space and just nice and punchy. In the pre-chorus, I've got like this lo-fi clap thing. I've put like a pan man on, just kind of going left and right and giving it a bit of space in there, a bit of movement, just so it's not so straight. For a bit of texture. This guy, which again, you'd never notice if you weren't listening out for it, but it just adds a bit of texture. So originally, it's this drum loop. This one. Yeah, this guy. So I've used that and stretched it and pitched it right down, like rolled all the lows out of it, and then used sound shifter, which I love as a, this is kind of like my go-to pitch shifter. I love what it kind of does to the, kind of blurs all the transients and kind of makes it sound real vibey, but this is the wave sound shifter, which I find does a really good job on like drum sounds and like good for like pitching vocals and stuff as well. So that's hiding down in there in the pre. Those that wood block is just the like Logic 70s kit, like percussion, which again is just, it just happened to be perfectly in key with the song. So another like happy meant to be accident, little wood block. I love that. Stella wasn't so keen on it, said it was a bit cheesy, but we managed to keep it in there in the end. I think it adds a bit of fun. She made me mute it in the post-chorus. That was our trade-off. Right, we'll keep it in the first part, but it's not allowed to be in there in the second part. Yeah, a few more other claps in the first post-chorus section. I've like added like a tambourine hit. You can kind of see the way, just if we're just looking at the drums. I would try and build it through the song, and ideally, you know, no two choruses are the same, or no two post-choruses are the same. There's always some kind of new element to come in, so that even if it's not super obvious, there's always something slightly different, so it kind of feels new and exciting. So in the second post-chorus, in the second la 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 la, in that part, we've got the full tambo going. So it's kind of, you know, it's different to that one, but it still feels the same. And it's just like making sure that each section is slightly new and different. So those are, yeah, very, very simple drums. I'm missing a couple of things in this session, but there's also like a ride cymbal that comes in at the end as like one final kind of ting, 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 like very kind of subtle in the final mix, but just adds that extra little bit of energy. So in terms of drums, that's pretty much all the drums in the track. So for me, that's pretty, that's as sparse as it gets, really. The girls are loving it. Girls are loving the beat, they're loving the vibe. You know, one of the big mistakes that I used to make is trying to fill in all the gaps, and you know, especially while people are trying to think up lyrics or melodies, you kind of feel like you still need to be doing something, and so you just constantly keep adding heaps of stuff and adding in like counter melody parts and adding in strings and all this kind of stuff, just as I guess something to do, when really all you're doing is you're taking up space in the song. And the more space that you can give singers and vocalists and writers to work with, the better. It's like, you know, I guess it's like if you hear some of like the hip hop beats that are huge hits, if you just hear the instrumentals, there's nothing going on there. It's just a vibe. So I knew once we had those elements, we had more than enough to start, you know, I could start structuring it up into a bit more of a classic kind of song structure, verse, pre and chorus. I knew that usually there needs to be something to break up the monotony of a two chord song. So I thought the pre-chorus would be a great place to do that. So I went back into my sample library and found another chord, Gat chord C. And so this just became the pre-chorus. And then, yeah, so after we had that pre-chorus part, I knew that that was probably all we needed for the whole song. And the way like Stella likes to record is, you know, she'll write down a bunch of like lyric ideas, and then I'll sort of do like a verse, pre-chorus and chorus structure, and she'll just freestyle melodies with her lyrics over the track, and we do that for, you know, 8 passes or something, and usually you can kind of start hearing when ideas are starting to run out, but often those first few takes where it's kind of fresh, like off of the top of the dome kind of thing, often works out to be the best, most like kind of inspiring fresh stuff. And then what we do, we go through, we check all the melodies, see which parts we really like, and then we start rearranging, like this part could be that would be a great verse melody. This part could work as the first part of the chorus. What if we took that line and that was the first part of the chorus, and then we took that melody as like the kind of the B part of the chorus, and then once we've got a melody that works, we can then make sure that the lyrics are working with that and start editing that as we go and start shaping it that way. And I think that's something that I've become pretty good at over the years, is helping to shape and mold and like structure up songs with people. I think a lot of that comes from, you know, working with the Leisure guys and learning from them as well. But that's part of the process that I really enjoy, is kind of picking the parts that are the most sort of catchy, and then we can reverse engineer like the song from that. So this is another kind of happy accident that I wasn't meaning to do, but in the rush of trying to do things fast, I made a mistake. And I was trying to copy and paste the first verse and pre into the second verse and pre, but instead I got the drag wrong and ended up so that the drums didn't come in until the pre-chorus. And then the oohs that we had in the first pre-chorus. Girl, those oohs that came in the pre-chorus were now coming in over the chorus, and it just worked and it sounded great. And sounded great dropping out of that, like the second verse, giving a bit of a break, like giving the ears a bit of a rest after all those intense drums, like just letting you reset and focus on what Stella's singing about, bring the drums in halfway through that chorus. So it still felt like, even like, it still felt like these parts are all kind of new because we haven't heard it in this format before. So even though we've heard all those parts individually, it still feels kind of new and exciting. So this is one of those like happy accidents where it just kind of seemed to work. Now later on, we had the, like at the end of the writing session in the States, we had the song up to, you know, we had two verses, two pre's and two choruses. And Stella was keen to get Gus Dapperton on it. And I wasn't too fussed about having Gus on the song. But I didn't think it needed it. But then when he wrote his part and he sent it back through, I thought it was awesome. And like, it was kind of real weird and kind of made the song. It was just like kooky enough to kind of push it over the edge. So he sent back some bridge vocals and he had added some extra la la la's in the final chorus. Like real nice and clean. So I thought it would be nice to try and introduced Gus into the song a little bit earlier, just so that it wasn't such a shock when this guy's voice came in out of nowhere. So because we now had the pre-chorus ooze underneath the chorus, it meant there was space now for another vocal to fit under that pre-chorus. So that's where I thought, oh, this could be a good place to put Gus. So that seemed to work quite well. And I resampled the that little lonely line from the very end of his Lars and chucked it in that little gap. So I felt like that all flowed pretty well. The other thing I've done with those Lars and those oohs, filter them in, just so that it was a different texture to the lead vocal and it didn't get in the way of the lead vocal. It just kind of set behind it, left enough space and left enough room for that lead vocal to sit on top, so you can see I've automated like a filter, filter ramp. Also helps to like kind of acts as like a little kind of riser, transitional effects riser thing, which helps to kind of make it feel more exciting as we're about to launch into the chorus or launch into the post-chorus as the second one is. So you can hear I've got a little bit of compression going on, nothing major. I'd probably gate that now just to get rid of some of that spill, but I didn't gate it at the time. And then a little bit more compression, Vox preset.
fucked up. I'm just a loser, shouldn't be with ya.
Like, I'm a big preset guy. I like presets.
Splice
and
presets.
Yeah, that's the same. If you take two things away today, it's you splice and presets. I just think, what's wrong with presets? Good place to start. Like, just bring up a preset, and if it sounds kind of good, then tweak it from there. It's about how it sounds. Again, I've got like maybe a few.
I'm just a looter, shouldn't be with ya.
Like a few dB of compression going on there. You know, having a couple of compressors in a row rather than one compressor like absolutely smashing it, I think is a better way to go. And then little bit of EQ. I should probably.
I'm just a looter.
Again, like, because this is not the final mix, I'd like to think that I would be tweaking this. I've obviously rolled off the lows.
I'm just a looter, shouldn't be with ya. Guess I'm a quitter while you're out there drinking.
Yeah, and then through old mate. But more compression. I remember, I think I got into this because I was always told that it was just, you don't do it. And then I remember talking to Joel when Joel was back once from LA. And I asked him, oh, have you ever used CLA vocals? And he's like, yeah, I use CLA vocals all the time. Like, that's what people use in LA, like in writing sessions to get like, because it's kind of that clean, like vocal pop sound. So I was like, oh, yes, well, I'm going to use CLA vocals then. So Joel uses it, and I use it. So, yeah, I'd endorse it. And then, yeah, now I've got that funny little high octave. If you listen carefully, you'll hear like a real high pitch vocal like this. But if you, like, I find if you... Something like that again, you listen to it on its own and it sounds ridiculous, but if you bury it in there,
I'm just a looter, shouldn't be with ya. Guess I'm a quitter while you're out there drinking. I'm just thinking about what I should have been.
You can't kind of get away with it, and it just adds extra energy. And you know, if you put put micro shift on it or something to make it wide.
I'm just a looter, shouldn't be with ya. Guess I'm a quitter while you're about to drink. I'm just thinking about what I should do. I've been lonely.
Good way to just add instant excitement and a light bit of that kind of high frequency energy. This was a mistake. That was her like kind of getting frustrated, I think. Which we then chopped in. We chopped in with a woo. That's a real stellar laugh. So that just came out of having a fun day, fun session.
Water pouring down from the ceiling. I knew this would happen. Still hard to believe it. Maybe I'm dramatic. I don't wanna see.